morning once again. As you can see, Kate and I are wearing our masks, trying to comply and understand all the things we can do to keep all of us safe. But in order for my glasses not to fog up and for you to hear me more clearly, we're going to take our masks off. We are socially distant by about 15 feet apart, and only one other person, Amanda, is here taking care of our recording equipment. We're glad you're able to join us, but we're going to take off our masks now to proceed with worship. Let us worship God.
Come rejoice in Christ Jesus, who welcomes us all.
Sheep and goats are welcome here. Saints and sinners are all part of God's world.
Come rejoice in Christ Jesus, who welcomes us all.
Come, let us share in his grace, that we all might become sheep who feed one another, who show compassion and love, who offer comfort and mercy, and who will give as we have received.
Come, rejoice in Christ Jesus, who welcomes us all.
Please join me in prayer. O God, searcher of the scattered, where the bullies and biased have gorged themselves at cruelty's banquet, you will serve them justice for dessert. Where the wounded are turned away by indifference, you will bandage them in the swaddling clothes of hope and love. Where the hungry press their foreheads against the windows of our grocery stores, you will open wide the doors and make place for all of us to be fed. Bringer of justice, when we would push the outsiders further away, you pull them closer to your heart. When we would shove the next to nothings aside to get to the front of the line, you pick them up and keep them right next to you. When we scatter our gifts, throwing them away on foolishness, you literally gather them up and give them back to us and say, "Here, try again." O God of spirit of common sense, as soon as we wander into the shadows of selfishness, you open the eyes of our hearts so we can truly see that place we call home with you. As soon as we think we can find you, only the rich and powerful, you set us aside and remind us to be humble as we approach you through Jesus Christ. O God of hope, God of love, and God of grace, be with us as we worship you now. In his name, amen.
Oh.
Weeks.
our prayer of reconciliation. Slow us down, Lord. We confess that it is too easy to get caught up in the mood of the coming season. On this week of Thanksgiving, let us put aside our rush to Christmas and offer our prayers of gratitude for your constant care. As the man who was healed of his leprosy returned to Jesus, thanking him for the healing, so help us return to you with our songs and spirits of praise. Open our hearts in actions of gratitude that we may truly offer our praise and thanksgiving to you. Amen.
Hear the sound of love poured out. We are not alone. No matter how lonely we may feel, God is always with us. God's loving care surrounds each and every one of us. Feel the power of God's love in you and be at peace. Amen.
Met royalty. I googled some of the things you must and must not do when you meet the queen. Apparently, the curtsy is very specific, and it sounds rather hard to do. 1 foot forward, bend both knees, and bow your head. And apparently, the longer that you curtsy and the lower you go down, the more respect you're showing. Luckily, the king that we serve is Jesus, and he doesn't ask us to curtsy or bow a certain way, or to speak to him a particular way, or even eat in a certain way. Yeah, there are rules about that too. No, Jesus asks us to treat everyone we meet the same way we would treat him. So tell the person sitting next to you whether you have ever met royalty or if you've ever done something for a king. And then listen to some of today's Bible story, and let's see if your answer changes. Then the king, Jesus, will say to those on his right, I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was homeless, you gave me a room. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me. And these people will say, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison and come to you? And then the king will say, I am telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things for someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it for me. Now, before I ask your question, my question again of you guys, my elementary school friends, let's think about this. Have you ever shared your lunch with someone who didn't have enough to eat? Or how about donating your pocket money to the Tree of Kindness, or choosing a tag off of the tree and going to the store and buying a toy for a child who maybe that's the only toy they're going to get this Christmas? Or maybe you can think of some other random acts of kindness that you have done. So I'm going to ask you again, have you ever met royalty or done something for a king? And if you can think of a time when you have done something like that, someone who couldn't repay you, someone who folks might think is less than or not worthy, well, then the answer is yes, you have done something for a king. Because Jesus says, when you do things like that for others, it's like you're doing it for him. I mean, think about it. If Jesus was sitting at your lunch table and he didn't have anything to eat, I don't think you would think twice about sharing your PB&J with him, would you? So maybe you could share with that kid whose clothes are always too small for him, or the little girl who you notice really never has anything in her lunchbox. If Jesus was homeless and cold, and he told you that he just needed a warm place for the night or a pair of shoes, I can guarantee that you wouldn't think twice about getting him a hotel room if you had the money for it, or a warm coat, or a hot drink. Am I right? So next time you don't want to take the time or the energy or give up your pocket money for someone less fortunate, imagine that it's Jesus who needs those shoes, or it's Jesus who is hungry or thirsty, cold and scared. And then let's see if your attitude changes. And the best thing, there is no curtsying involved.
Today's prayer for understanding God's word. Compassionate God, let these words help us to show compassion to all whom we meet. Help us see your face in every hungry child, in every tired woman, in every disappointed man. Help us hear your cry in every person who mourns, every person who is lonely, every person who is in agony. Help us feel your presence that we might have the courage and the confidence to act with compassion and love everywhere we go and with everyone we meet. Amen. And our New Testament epistle is from Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15 to 23. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, the power through things in my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take. Thank you. when Christ shall come. The shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Before I read today's gospel lesson, today is Christ the King Sunday, a title that I think if they were a little bit more sensitive to the language of the day, we might find Christ the day or the celebration of being lifted up. Regardless of how you feel about the title of King, Christ is our Messiah. And we come to the end of this liturgical year, which always begins with the first Sunday of Advent, which will be next Sunday. But going throughout the year of Advent and Christmas and Epiphany, that period of time leading up to Easter called Lent, and then we enter into that Eastertide and Pentecost. And so this liturgical year will be concluding today, year A. It's in three different years of cycles, and so we'll enter year B next week. But as we think about the final scriptures chosen for this particular year, there's no finer chapter that I can think of that we could lift up the role of Christ as the ultimate teacher and savior of humanity, encouraging us to be the better person we can be. Also this week, our governor has stated that we are on the level of purple in terms of dealing with the COVID crisis. I thought about changing our colors from the wonderful traditional white of Christ the King Sunday to maybe purple to remind us of that. But regardless, we come as God's people to hear God's word and to be shaped by that word, to be as healthy and productive for the purposes of God than ever before. So let us listen to these precious verses out of the 25th chapter of Matthew. Matthew writes, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, just as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' Then the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison, and we did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. O God, we live at times that no one has been prepared for. The changing of colors, not only in our pyramids, but the changing of colors about the safety of how we live in community, have dictated how we should live. But, O God, your word rings true this day, that you ask us to take a look at our lives and ask us, where have we demonstrated your presence within us, regardless of the health concerns around us? Help us this day to feel liberated and free to be your people, regardless of the time and the place in which we live. Free us to be your presence to this world, so that those that might not have a pillow to lay their head on at night will find comfort. Those who might be hungry will be fed. And those that do not have clothes to keep them warm will be clothed in something that will keep them warm. O God, more important than anything's going on in our world or nation right now, we are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we think about how we might demonstrate our faith, it has been said, don't tell me what you believe. Let me watch you live your life, and I will tell you what and how you believe. I think we show that each and every day, that we're challenged to exhibit our faith in such a way that, as someone else has said, we become the only Bible some people will ever read. And how will they know about God if we don't show them? The challenge this day is to take this word that was written 2,000 years ago and let it become alive in your very life. And so this sermon is a time for us to pause here at the end of the liturgical year and say, how in our particular lives, our individual and our corporate life as a congregation, have we exhibited the faith in Jesus Christ? When people hear about the church on the little hill in this part of Placerville, what do they think? What do they know? When they look at you when you walk down your street or take a walk with your dog or see you in the shopping store, do they stop and say, hey, that there goes a person that has made a difference in this world? Frederick Buechner has written many, many books, and he has shared some powerful quotes, and I'd like to share with you one of them now. He says, the place God calls you to is the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. As we've been talking this past month about the multitude of gifts and talents that we've been given, those talents are not to be hidden, not to be stored away for a rainy day, but to be exposed to the light of God and shared in our community in a powerful way. And so, as Buechner says, taking those gifts that you've been given, where can we allow them to be applied in our world to make a difference? One of the difficult things that we are going through as a nation is this deep divide not just between two candidates, but almost between two different worldviews, about groups that are willing to wear a mask to protect others and those that don't, that those that fly big flags representing one party or another. And I think it's time again that the church, the body of Christ, step forward and say there's a better way. That no matter who you are or how disjointed or separated you are from your family and friends and others, there's a way to be brought together with our differences intact and realize that there's something larger and something more important, that we are God's now and always. And whether it's through the voice of Frederick Buechner or others that have inspired you, we ask that you would take time today to take a look at how you might be inspiring others with the faith you live. As we live out this faith, we're also challenged to allow this word to permeate our bodies. And what does it mean to hear these words from Matthew 25? It comes at an end of Matthew where he's really trying to push people to understand that Jesus Christ, born of Joseph and Mary, was the Messiah that the Jewish nation had been hoping and praying for generations. From the beginning of his gospel to this point, he allows people to enter into this, if you will, dialogue with Jesus through Matthew's words, to realize that this is the one they had hoped for. From the root of Jesse all the way up to this point, leading up to his arrest and his conviction, his crucifixion, and his resurrection, to the scenes with his disciples where they see him in the resurrected form. My friends, how does that story of Jesus as the Messiah encourage you to live your faith? We might be separated by 2,000 years, but the reality, we're only separated by the reading of a sentence or a story. And when that becomes real to us, God calls us to exhibit our faith in ways that we might not have ever experienced or expected. So as we listen to this word, what does it mean to truly believe in the power of God? It's to take that next step. The other day, I was walking our dog and I was going through a park and this wonderful grassy meadow with some beautiful liquid amber trees turning colors. And there was a young family there with a beautiful blanket out, and it looked like they were getting ready for a Sunday afternoon picnic with their new baby. And the baby was about a year old, I'm guessing, because they were holding the child up with their fingers, allowing the child to hang on to their hands. And you could see the one parent with a phone trying to videotape maybe the child's first steps. And you could see the smile on the child's face, trying to figure out how to move their weight from one foot to another. And to realize that those first steps are a lot like us. Sometimes we need to hang on literally to the hands of God and take that step of faith and say, God, I know I can do better, and I know you've got a great plan for me. Help me walk in my faith in such a way that when people see me, they no longer see me, but see you in this world. To take the time to go embrace someone who might be in need, or to go visit or call someone who is sick. To take time to notice the man that might be begging at the stoplight. Not to give them money, but to give them something more than money. Maybe some food, maybe a word of hope. Asking them where's the last time they've had a decent place to be and feel safe. To engage them as a human being. My friends, as we close out this liturgical year, God is calling you. God is with you. God is directing you, just as that small child, just as in the people of this great story out of the Gospel of Matthew, to come and be with God. Because our only hope in this world, is to be so close with God, we realize that our entire citizenship lies in heaven. And God has blessed us to live in this time and place just as he chose the disciples of Jesus' day, just as he chose the saints to live in whatever generation and century they have lived in, to show forth God's presence to this world. Don't miss this opportunity. Come and walk and praise God for what you're about to do to make a difference in this world. For you have been chosen to walk by faith. Let me pray for you. Gracious Lord, you call us into this sacred space, and even though we have not gathered here in a particular sanctuary, your sanctuary is much broader and deeper than any walls of any particular church. And so wherever your people have gathered this day, in front of a computer or on their cell phone, whether they've gathered as an individual or as a group or a family, you have made us the body of Christ. We may not be connected by the ligaments and the bones and the flesh, but we are connected by the Holy Spirit. And we are here to be your people, to make a difference in this world. Oh God, you alone know how difficult these divisions have been in our country and in our world. You know the particular needs of the hungry and the lost all over the face of the earth. And now you have blessed us with your Son. Help us to live in him so that we can make a difference in all that we think, say, and do, following the footsteps of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Calls out to the man on the street, "Sir, can you help me? It's so cold and I've nowhere to sleep. Is there somewhere you can tell me?" He walks on, doesn't look back. He pretends he can't hear her and starts to whistle as he crosses the street. Seems embarrassed to be there. Oh, think twice, it's just another day for you and me in paradise. Oh, think twice, it's just another day for you. For you and me in paradise. Oh, think
We come to that sacred place in worship where we're invited to open our souls and hearts and minds to the presence of God in prayer. Oftentimes in prayer, we think it's ourselves articulating unto God, but a more important part of prayer is listening to God, listening to the leading of the Holy Spirit. So I invite you now to enter into this sacred time of prayer with a moment of silence. O God, we feel so loved when we realize how much you love us. It transforms our very lives. O God, in the world in which we live, we find ourselves torn about the things we see on the television set or hear on the radio about the divisions among people that should love one another. And O God, I know that you've called us to be a reconciling agent, only because of the power of your Son, Jesus Christ, who found himself in many places of conflict, but always with the wisdom of yourself, O Lord, said things that brought people into a realization that we are all your people. In the time of Jesus, things were separated because you were either Jew or non-Jewish. Today, we find ourselves divided by political parties, or the color of our skin, or the language we speak, or the separation of people because of their own sexuality. But we're all your people. So bind us together this day, not so much because of what we can do, but what you can do through us. Be that reconciling agent on this Christ the King Sunday that truly shows your presence in all of the world. This week, we receive special prayer requests from several people. As we say and read these names, O God, hear our joint prayers. We pray for a friend of George and Lillian Stephenson. His name is Frank Bednar. He is ill. Bring your holy touch to heal him. We pray for a friend of Dan Heron. His name is Shannon Parsley. He lives in Florida and has COVID and right now refuses a ventilator. Comfort him and be with the doctors and nurses that are trying to treat him. We also pray this day for Miles Dixon for the loss of his father, Greg. We continue to pray for John and Kathy Roberts' son and family, Adam, Jane, Mayel, and Masio, as they are recovering from COVID. Strengthen them and keep them well. We pray for Leah Hall's son, Ray Lewis, and for Stephen Henke, Doris Henke's son. We pray for our good friend, Sue Prock, as she recovers from a hip procedure. We pray for Leah Hall, and we pray for Dave Friend, of Fredland's mother-in-law, Bev Clark. And now, O God, hear the names of the people that are lifted up by those that are watching this recorded service. Hear the names and send your Holy Spirit to all those needs. And now, O Lord, lead us in the prayer that your Son taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We pray that this Christ the King Sunday has been a blessing to you. Let us continue to pray and lift up our neighbors and friends and family as people are unable to travel like they would like to for the celebration of Thanksgiving. May we realize that we do have an opportunity to still be thankful. Thankful for the gift of life that God has given us. So may you live out your faith this week, filled with the Holy Spirit in such a way that life is not only transformed within you, but all those around you will see the light of God. And now may the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.